morning and a warm welcome to our prayer during the day service this morning, Thursday the 24th of September. O God, make speed to save us. Make me a clean heart, O God. Jesus, Saviour of the world, come to us in your mercy. We look to you to save and help us by your cross and your life laid down. You set your people free. We look to you to save and help us. When they were ready to perish, you saved your disciples. We look to you to come to our help. In the greatness of your mercy, loose us from our chains, forgive the sins of all your people. Make yourself known as our Saviour and mighty deliverer. Save us and help us, that we may praise you. Come now and dwell with us, Lord Christ Jesus. Hear our prayer and be with us always. And when you come in your glory, make us to be one with you and to share the life of your kingdom. Amen. Psalm today is the first 8 verses of Psalm number 37. The salvation of the righteous comes from the Lord. Fret not because of evildoers. Be not jealous of those who do wrong.
But they shall soon wither like grass, and like green.
Trust in the Lord and be doing good. Dwell in the land and be nourished with truth.
Let your delight be in the Lord, and he will give you your hearts.
Commit your way to the Lord and put your trust in him, and he will bring it to pass.
He will make your righteousness as clear as the light, and your thirsting as the noonday.
Be still before the Lord and wait for him. Do not fret over those who prosper as they follow their evil schemes.
Refrain from anger and abandon wrath. Do not fret, lest you be moved to do evil.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Blessed and holy God, ever merciful and forgiving, may we turn from what is evil and do what is good in your sight. For you have saved us by the cross of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Scripture reading this morning is from Acts 17, who would like to know what it means. Now all the Athenians and the foreigners living there would spend their time in nothing but telling or hearing something new. Then Paul stood up in front of the Areopagus and said, Athenians, I see how extremely religious you are in every way. For as I went through the city and looked carefully at the objects of your worship, I found among them an altar with the inscription, to an unknown God. What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it, he who is Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in shrines made by human hands, nor is he served by human hands, as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mortals life and breath and all things. From one ancestor he made all nations to inhabit the whole earth, and he allotted the times of their existence and the boundaries of the places where they would live, so that they would search for God and perhaps grope for him and find him, though indeed he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As even some of our own poets have said, for we too are his offspring. Since we are God's offspring, we ought not to think that the deity is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of mortals. While God has overlooked the times of human ignorance, now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day to which he will have the world judged in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. When they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some scoffed, but others said, we will hear you again about this. At that point, Paul left them, but some of them joined him and became believers, including Dionysus and the Arab guide, and a woman named Maris, and others with him. Thanks be to God.
And now a reflection on that passage, and the line in particular, I found an altar with the inscription, to an unknown God. The encounter between Paul and the intellectuals of Athens is skillfully condensed by Luke into a speech that would have lasted less than 2 minutes. Presumably he would have spoken for much longer, but this sophisticated argument highlights the virtues of lucidity and brevity. Paul's speech is subtly contextual. He shows respect for the religious culture of Athens, and through the altar to an unknown God, establishes a bridge to Jewish monotheism and then to Jesus. We have much to learn from his approach, not least when it comes to articulating the essential mystery of God. So often we get trapped into justifying facile and simplistic views of God we do not even hold. I once met someone who, when asked how he can possibly believe in God, replied, "Tell me what you mean by God, and I'll tell you whether I believe in him myself." The apophatic view of God, that God's essence remains a mystery, is a major resource we all too easily overlook. At a time when many practice mindfulness, we need to recover this aspect of our tradition. A few minutes each day spent in meditation can enlarge our view of God, while enabling us to speak to the culture of our day. Yet we must also combat the drift into purely privatized expressions of faith. Writers about Christian meditation have always assumed an active participation in congregational life. Amen. We come now to our prayers. That this and all our days may be full of your praise, we pray to you, O Lord, that you will keep us this day without sin. We pray to you, O Lord, that we may walk before you in the paths of righteousness and peace. We pray to you, O Lord, that you will bless your people and lift them up forever. We pray to you, O Lord, that you will guide and protect us by your Holy Spirit and bring us with your saints to glory everlasting. We pray to you, O Lord. We bring before God this morning our church. We pray for our own diocese, for all those who are ministers in our churches, particularly today for David Molden, who is in the canonry benefice. We pray for all those who worship there, for the schools in that area. And we pray too in the worldwide church for the dioceses of Panyana in South Sudan, for the Central Solomons in Melanesia and Central Tanganyika in Tanzania. We remember today all those who will come together in fellowship and worship. We pray too for those around the world who are unable to practice their worship and their belief in the places that they live. We pray for our world. We pray for those pressures on the environment to which we all contribute. We ask, Lord, that you will give us a more sympathetic and understanding approach. Help us all to think carefully about the way in which we use the environment around us. We pray for all refugees, for those seeking asylum, for those people who are victims of war. We pray for all who live in fear. And we pray, Lord, for our own town here in Tenterden and St Michael's and Smallhithe. We pray for the schools and all those who are trying to return to a life of more normality. We pray for those people in our town who are under the threat of unemployment. For all who are anxious at this time about their business. For all who make decisions at a local level that affect the day-to-day life we live. We remember today all those who live in Chalk Avenue, in Leslie Crescent, Wayside and Wayside Avenue, And we remember with gratitude before you, Lord, all those who take responsibility for cleaning our churches. Heavenly Father, we bring before you now all those who are in need. We pray for those who today wait anxiously for test results. We pray for those who are in hospital or in care homes and feel alone, for their families who are unable to visit at this time. We pray for those who are suffering at home, for those who are sitting at bedsides at this time. And we remember Francis Sherwood, Alan Hutchinson, David Bolton, Muriel Davies, Joe Coley, Jenny Jordan, June Bennett, Amanda Chalmers, Matthew Meredith, Monica Clinch, and Mary Finnis. We ask, Lord, that you are with them at this time. And we bring before you, Lord, those who have died recently. Among them we pray for Jen Milner and Mike Hockley, for Carol Day and Peter Manning. Be with those who mourn their death. Give them comfort and strength. And bring all who have died to your glory everlasting. And now let us commend ourselves and all for whom we pray to the mercy and protection of God. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you for all the benefits that you have won for us, all the pains and insults that you have borne for us. Most merciful Redeemer, friend and brother, may we know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly, day by day. Amen. And now we join together in the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. May Christ our Saviour give us peace. Amen. Amen.